The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
The Revolution with Juan McCartney is sponsored by J.S. Johnson, Burger King, Commonwealth Bank, Wendy's, Ron's Electric Motors, Scotia Bank, and Island Wholesale.
Good afternoon, Bahamas, and welcome to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney, so good to have you with us. We are today, I had something planned out for today, actually, but what I'm going to do, because I forgot that the Association for the Blind, because it's Blindness Awareness Month, I believe. I have them coming on after the 1 o'clock break. So we're going to kind of open the field with some different things that you can talk about if you'd like. I really did want to get into what I wanted to talk about, but I'm going to do so in fullness with, what does this say? One, I hope you reporters are following the Brian Laundrie case, because reports are sightings and signs are saying he's in the Bahamas. Even John Walsh on Inside Edition last night said that he could be chilling in Freeport. I hear them saying that. I mean, and insofar as I'm not sure what you'd like us to do about it, we could go down there and look for him, I guess. I mean, but... If they say they see him, they need to, and he's a wanted fugitive or whatever, they need to call the Royal Bahamas Police Force. That's the appropriate agency. But if we do have sightings of him that are true, or that we believe are to be true, then we'll be more than happy to cover that. But so far, I've only heard the reports of one lady in Freeport saying she thinks she saw someone like him, and there's never white people around here, which it's counterintuitive. It would be counterintuitive for a white person who's one of the most sought after people in the United States of America to go near to a country near the United States of America where the population is predominantly black, and you pop up and you're the only white person. But Barefoot Bandit did it. So you never know what could be going on there, but we'll keep our eyes peeled for any reports of sightings of him. All right. Where was I? Oh, yes. Okay. So, I'm gonna actually get into it, right? What I was gonna get into. You know, no, I'm not, because I want to deal solely with this issue, but I'll give you a teaser on the basis of the discussion, because we have a lot of talk lately about our colonial past and the vestiges of colonialism and slavery and how those things still impact us today. And one of the things that impacts us is our view of ourself, right? So this idea that we still tie ourselves to the trappings of colonialism and slavery, right? And how we view that through the institutions that we inhabit, how we view that to the titles we assume, how we view that through colorism, all right, and separation of race in the Bahamas. And that's what I wanted to get into. And I wanted to have a full-throated discussion about it. And I don't want to do that and then talk with the Association for the Blind and then go from there. So I'll open the field up for commentary from the public. If you want to call me, you can do so at 323-6232, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4316, and 325-4259. Says, do we have any blind athletes? I see a blind American who's running below 11 seconds in the 100 meters. You know, that's a good question. It says, good day, Mr. McCartney. Who was that in Abaco someone saw a sighting of? I missed the first few minutes of the show. Thanks. Brian Lounge is someone from Grand Bahama said they thought they saw him there. Okay? Now, he's the guy that's wanted in the United States for questioning. Let me not, for questioning in the death of Gabby Petito, all right? Gabby Petito is an American lady, young American lady who went missing, and then they found her. She travels a lot. She would blog a lot, and she went missing, and then... Oh, yeah. There it is. So she went missing... I'm pulling up the story now about the Bahamas. She went missing, and then they found her body, and they say she died by strangulation. Her boyfriend was also missing now, and he's a person of interest in her murder. All right? So that's what's happening with Brian Lowndry. Someone says they saw him in Grand Bahama. Yeah. So, in fact, let's see here. I'm trying to do this, pull the story up. It says, and here's the thing, right? So, someone in Grand Bahama says they thought they saw him. And now someone in North Carolina yesterday says they believed they saw him. All right? So, he's, you know... Slim, bald, white boy. Pretty nondescript. So, if you see a slim, bald... anyway, you can call us if you'd like. 323-6232, 325-4316, and 325-4259. The text line is 422-4796. I'm up for whatever. We're not going to talk about colonialism, racism, colorism, and economic inequality today, but we will do so next week. This is Man Juan, Clint doing damage control all over Guardian talk shows. His shows, his friends are sure welcoming. Yeah, I mean, like I said the other day, I heard some of him on Levin's show, and he was on Nahaja's show. And, you know, no disrespect to Levin or Nahaja, but they don't work in news. So Clint can tell y'all anything, and y'all will not know how to respond to it. You only see what you see on TV about news coverage around the globe. There are those of us who are intensely invested in this. And really, my... advice for Clint would be to like let it go. You know, what are you seeking to accomplish here? There's no need for it, and we're not gonna abide by it, right? I've talked to 5 or 6 cabinet ministers in the past few days, and they were like, I'm not going through him to get, you know what I mean? We're not gonna give you our scoop. We're not gonna call you for interview requests. If you want to be helpful to us as a press corps, we're not going to fill out any accreditation form. Maybe Zedness will. I don't know. We're still going to come to the OPM when there's press conferences and we're not filling out any accreditation form and there's nothing you could do about it. Okay? Absolutely nothing. So I don't know what you're seeking to achieve. We're still going to go up to cabinet ministers and talk to them at events. We're still going to ask respectfully to the prime minister for interviews at events. There's no reason for any of this, okay? Just let it go. That's my advice to you. You're my friend. Let it go. Let it go. I'm not going to sing again. Just let it go, okay? Levin doesn't know anything about news coverage. That's like, Levin knows as much about covering the news, and Levin's my friend, but I'm just giving you perspective on perhaps why Clint is going on these people's show. Levin knows as much about covering the news as I know about how the Defense Force works. Okay? So if you want to come talk to me, Clinton, I can explain to you why your logic and reasoning is flawed. By all means, come do so. But I don't know what it is you're seeking to achieve by going on all these people's show. I just let it go, man. Just let it go, right? We want a good relationship with you. Like I said, you want to be of use to us. Just let us know where the prime minister is going to be and when. And if he will be taking questions. Even if he wouldn't be taking questions, we'd still go. And you know that. So just be of use to us in that way. You don't have to make busy work for yourself and accreditation forms and have all this hubbub and ruckus, right? Just facilitate something that's much more simpler than what you're trying to do. There's really no point to it. Is there a security threat? I think you're telling Levin we're the security threat to these cabinet. I ain't trying to be throw shade, right? But you take security with you when you go see your sweetheart in the middle of the night. You take security with you when y'all used to be in these bars and restaurants all at night. What's the, anybody could come up to y'all? What's the threat we pose? Listen, Eddie's saying that you can't cover. First of all, if you go anywhere in the world, and he's traveled as a working journalist around the world, as have I, right? If you go anywhere in the world and you are a working journalist from a different country, you have to get a visa or some sort of accreditation from that country. The same thing here. Their journalists don't need it. Candia Dames covered, when she worked in Baltimore, right? Baltimore, Maryland. She covered Congress, the United States Congress. She was a student journalist. She had her ID from her workplace. All right? And the security around the White House is massive, right? Not the White House, around Congress is massive. They got metal detectors, guards all over the place. They were allowed to go up to any member of Congress, Senate, or House of Representatives. She interviewed Donald Rumsfeld, just walked up to him. He was then the Secretary of Defense, just walked up to him. I've been to Cuba, Jamaica, where else? All right? You have to get accredited if you go there, and then you're allowed to talk to these people, right? There was no wall around Andrew Holness when he came here for the opening of Sandals. He talked to people. He was interviewed by reporters. It doesn't arise, right? When we were accredited, here's how bizarre I find all this. We went to Cuba, and we had to go to Cuba and get accredited. Cuba, right? We went to Santiago de Cuba, where they were having a CARICOM heads of government meeting. Ingram was prime minister, all right? And all that was required was for Ingram to say, they're with us, let them in. We interviewed at least 5 or 6 different prime ministers and heads of state. Raul Castro was feet away, all right? He had a security retinue. But this bizarre, like, barriers you're trying to create, I don't get it. I don't get what you're doing. I would let it go. You're my friend. I'll let it go. All right? That's all I'm saying. I don't know why you're on all the talk shows. All right? We don't need this. All right? Security threat. This is Juan. You vibing hard. Just retire every day. You gripe and complain like a gal. Well, that's sexist. Only women gripe and complain because you're griping and complaining. Says I'll turn Guardian not off. I'll turn off Guardian at 12 now instead of 2. All right, have fun. There's a plethora of programming you could listen to. Juan, simply like Levin and Naja, kindly invite Clint Watson on your show and talk to him man to man to see what this goal or objective is. I've already talked to Clint, man to man. He called me. I talked to him. He said that we can still get interviews, come to press conferences, and I said, well, great, let's do that. Says, I want to see you and Clint make up. I don't like this Discord. Oh, Lord. There's no discord. I don't know, man. Just, I don't get what it is that you're, you know? I don't get it. I'm not going to lie to you. I don't get it. We're still going to be here doing our job, all right? So, I don't get it. I'm sorry. We got a phone call? 323-6232. I don't know why people message me and have these hissy fits. They're going to cut the radio. Just cut the radio off. Just don't listen. There are many other people who will listen. I don't get it. I don't get these people. All right? It says, Juan, the person who said they'll turn off Guardian at 12, all because you disagree with Clint, must be Clint texting for another number. I don't know, man. I don't know. I don't get it. We're not gonna follow any of it. So I don't get why you're doing it. That's just me. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Holiday, this is Doc, you know, so long with you on.
Hey, man, what's happening?
I'm right here, man, thank God.
All right.
I have two questions.
Mm-hmm.
One, the guy was locked up for the damaging of, alleged damaging of Columbus, right?
Mm-hmm.
My concern is, I wondered how they could charge him with trespassing when the place was not cordoned off.
The government house?
Right.
How they could charge him with trespassing?
Right.
I mean, what do you mean?
Because if the construction work were going on there, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think they should have the whole place cordoned off.
I gotcha. He wasn't allowed on the ground, so that's why the trespassing comes in.
Yep. But what I'm saying is the ground should have been cordoned off.
I gotcha. Okay.
Other point is, for the simple reason that they were doing construction work. My other question is, right? Now, you talked about Clint. Now, I'm not really, you know, getting into this situation, but something came to my mind.
But y'all brought Clint up, you know, not me. I didn't bring him up. But anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, but what came to my mind as you were speaking, right? I said to myself, what happened if they have something set whereby they give the government officials so many securities that when they come out of meetings, they just jump in their car and pull off.
Say that again.
Okay, take for instance, right?
Mm-hmm.
When they come out, the government officials, right? The car could be there and they could have so much security. I'm not saying it happened, but happening, but I want to know if it's going to happen. Whereby they have so many security that when the government official comes out, they just get in the car and pull off.
Raymond, I don't know what you're talking about. Let me go to another phone call. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hi, good afternoon. Juan McCartney?
Yes, sir.
Yes, nothing personal, but I'd like your honest opinion on the matter. I mean, I just heard a portion of it. I don't know if your show is based on it today, but if you were Mr. Clint Watson, sir,
mm-hmm.
and you were offered the job that he has now
mm-hmm.
for the position, would your objective view still be the same? I mean, I just say, I mean, he was offered a job. We all know how our country runs. So if he's offered this job, would you have the same views? You know, would you be speaking from his position and you have the same view, or you would have other views?
If I had
his position.
Sure, no problem. If I had his position, my goal would be to keep the media informed of where the prime minister is going to be. My goal would be to let the prime minister know that there are certain concerns that the media has and advise him on how to address him. My goal would be to organize press conferences, et cetera. So that would be my goal. And I'll see why that can't happen now without other stuff going on.
Well, I respect and appreciate your honest answer. I really value that from you.
Thanks.
I know you as a genuine and I know you're an upfront person, so I appreciate that. I hope you guys can work together and don't make it seem like a divide, because all of you guys should be fighting for the same cause. And he's a product of the media, so I think he should now extend olive branch and you all work together let's go to this country. So, you know, I mean, despite what everyone else is saying, I don't think it's a divide. And I think that you should unify, and Clinton, and you should work hand in hand, or all the other reporters.
I agree. You know? I agree.
Right?
I agree.
Yeah, so y'all just try to work it out. We ain't going to make it about a division, you know, because I know you, and I know you're a good person. I know Clint. And I feel like don't let the public and don't let people try to muddy up the water. So let's work together. Clint in a new position. He's sort of out of his element. You know, let's work with him. Let's soon just put him on a target and then shoot arrows at him. Let's just try to, you know, tweak him and adjust a little bit and work with him a little bit. Do you understand what I'm saying?
I got you, yeah.
All right, brother.
I'm here to help. Yeah.
Thank you. Respect. Appreciate everything. Yeah.
Okay. Y'all brought up Clint, you know, not me. I didn't bring him up. There's no vibe, all right? I'm just being honest about what it is that our position is, and that's it, you know? That's it. It says, hi, Juan. They will listen twice as hard now. It says, oh, man. I don't want to make it about Clint today, dude. I don't have no issues with Clint. As I said, we're just not going to follow the guidelines that don't make sense. That's it. All right? That's the long and short of it, all right? Now, I want to talk about, and y'all are going to get mad again, all right? I want to talk about the lead story in the Nassau Guardian today, all right? And this is the FNM expects Minnis to go. And FNM Deputy Leader Peter Turnquest is speaking pretty clearly about it, all right? He's saying that they expect Dr. Minnis to keep his word and not offer for leadership at the party's next convention as the organization looks to rebuild with a leader that possesses different qualities, all right? The organization is looking to rebuild with a leader that possesses different qualities. Now, if you heard me yesterday, right, I talked about how the FNM isn't putting forward the appearance of a party that realizes the gravity of what just happened and that it really suffered a devastating loss and they haven't examined why, all right? Now, yesterday, we have Peter Turnquest actually, as the deputy leader, actually presenting, which makes me think that the stuff that's been coming out from the FNM, he hasn't had a hand in, and a lot of the cabinet ministers who were there hadn't had a hand in, right? So, Turnquest is acknowledging that the party needs to rebuild, and he's acknowledging that they need a leader with different qualities. Why? Because the current leader has qualities that were not successful, certainly in shaping public opinion, all right? Here's what Turnquest says. He says, Minnis, has indicated to council that he will not offer as a candidate for leader at the upcoming convention, and based upon that, any further discussion of his position would only invite unhelpful speculation. He has indicated that he will not offer, and the council has taken him as his word. All right? When asked what kind of leader he wants to see take over the party, Turnquest replied, "We need a more inclusive leader, someone who's willing to embrace all of the various segments of the party or organizations of the party, who's willing to be open to consultation and advice from others, who will be confident in who they are and be able to express themselves with confidence and display the kind of vision and strength that is necessary to lead a party like the Free National Movement going forward." I want y'all to hear what this man's saying, all right? He says, somebody who will stand up to the challenge of being in opposition to point out the areas where the government may be falling short or may be acting outside of their mandate of what they had promised the Bahamian people, all right? Now, Turnquest said the party would prefer that its next leader be a sitting MP. However, he added, that's not necessarily a qualification. So they're opening up the party. Why are y'all still talking about? This says, I sound salty. You kind of sound salty. If you seem not to respect the role Clint has been given, I respect the role that he's been given. Insofar as becoming a bulwark between us and the prime minister and ministers, then that's just not going to happen. So I don't know. I mean, again, I don't want to argue with Clint. I know I love him. I've known him a long time. All right. I know him a long time, and I don't want to argue with him. I just want to do my job. That's all. That's all I want, is to do my job. Anyway, Turnquest is talking about leadership willing to be inclusive. Now, tell me who this doesn't sound like. Leadership willing to be inclusive. Leadership willing to embrace all of the various segments of the party or organizations of the party. All right? Let me explain why he's saying this, right? So Dr. Minnis had a reputation for many in the FNM I spoke to, all right, of isolating those who he saw as not being fully supportive of the decisions he was making. So if you're disagreeing with him, he isolates you, all right? He had a reputation, and this is true, all right, of trying to remove from influence those FNMs who were particularly supportive of former Prime Minister Hubert Ingram, all right? We got a phone call? That's fine. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, pleasant. Good afternoon, Juan. How you doing?
I'm great, man. How's it going?
I'm doing fine, thank you. I was hoping to get on after you was finished making this point, but nonetheless, I get off on right where you left off. I'd like to make a couple quick points on this matter that you're discussing.
Sure.
And then I want to make one point on my Prime Minister, Prime Minister Davis, right?
Mm-hmm.
Relating to this whole press secretary mess, right? One, if I could take you back to the beginning of when the former Prime Minister, Hubert Minnis, took over leadership of the FNM. There were lifetime council members such as Darren Cash and others who were removed from their platform. They were identified as lifetime members because they brought a certain level of character, integrity, commitment, loyalty, et cetera, upliftment to the organization, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did you remember that period in the FNM's history?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay, and so I'm bringing up that point to share this point with the country and to demonstrate and to tie back into what you were saying. And that point that I'm elaborating on that you made is that you need to have differentiating points of views at the table and be able to respect them. And actually, that was Peter Turnquest, the deputy leader of the FNM's point,
correct, right?
I completely agree with that and support that because it's the right approach. And anything less that compromises such an approach, you are going to be burying your head in the sand like the ostrich, and you're going to be heading for the definitive conclusion that the former prime minister and his government found themselves in, which is 32 to 7 seats in parliament and a complete disdain when he had the complete love and loyalty of the Bahamian people in the 2017 elections. Mm-hmm. With what Hubert Minnis did, he destroyed the FNM when he moved out all of the persons that brought objectivity to their party, and he replaced them with yes, sir, and yes, ma'am, people in their council. And as a result, you could see today, Juan, that even those yes, sir, people and those yes, ma'am, people in the FNM dislike the very person who put them there. And so it doesn't work. It may work for a short period of time, but at the end of the day, if you're not doing right, you will suffer the same consequences, which is a complete reversal of what you intended to establish in the first place. Now, on to my point, with reference to the press secretary mess, right?
Mm-hmm.
With reference to my prime minister, okay. Prime Minister Davis. I worked very hard, Juan, over the last 4 years and 3 months. I suffered many blows and made many sacrifices to see my prime minister established as prime minister with his government, Juan. And at the private swearing-in for Prime Minister Davis, Juan, our nose was already set up in the room. I was there as a person taking photographs of that situation. Our nose was established in the room. They had already set up, had a camera person there, et cetera. Had a crew there, had photographers there to cover the matter. Some word came down. They were told that only BIS was permitted to be in the room, right? Mm-hmm. When the prime minister came on, and he saw them downstairs outside, it was brought to his attention by, I think, the PS or secretary to the governor general, Mr. Thompson. The prime minister stopped. He was already heading on the inside one. He stopped and told them to correct that. And he ensured that our news and their photographers and their film crew was invited back up to the room where his private swearing in as a cabinet minister was taking place, as the Minister of Finance. And so I said I'd want to say this. That's the kind of prime minister that we have in this country. He wants to ensure at all costs and within order, decency, and protocols that the media is provided access to provide coverage, to provide the information to the Bahamian people. Okay? Anyone who's getting in the way of that or creating a mess of that, I personally have a problem with. I don't know how we went from that one to this whole mess in the media. But this is not what my leader stands for, and this is not what he represents. And I hope that it's corrected and swiftly. Thank you for the opportunity, Juan.
All right. Thanks, Anton. I hope we can stop talking about it, to be honest with you. I don't know why we're still going on with it, to be perfectly honest with you. Let's take a break. We got open line today. You can call me. Talk about whatever you like. We're going to talk more about the FNM. And we'll be back on the other side.
BK Nassau and Pepsi want to bring you a fun day on us. Upgrade your favorite combo and get a chance to win great prizes like staycations at Atlantis or Bahamar, powerboat adventure excursions, or a Blue Lagoon dolphin encounter. You can also win a relaxing day at Sandy Toes or a VIP movie experience at Fusion. Upgrade your combo at any of BK Nassau's 7 locations and enter to win at bk242.com. Win fun days with Pepsi and Burger King, where taste is king.
You have a new text message from Scotia.
Scotiabank is adding text messaging to its communication channels to keep customers updated in quicker and safer ways. As of November 4th, Scotiabank will be using text messaging to provide notifications on the minimum payment required for your credit card and due dates. Customers may continue to access their credit card statements on Scotia Online or through our mobile banking app. Learn more by contacting customercare-bahamas@scotiabank.com or call 356-1697.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Oh, boy. It says, thank God Anton put that baby to sleep. Now let's stop talking about Clinton, this nonsense. It's a quick way through Davis administration to fill. I'm going to stop talking about it. Y'all brought it up. You notice I didn't say anything more about it since Monday. I'm going to stop talking about it. I'm just going to continue to do my job. I don't know. It's a lot of it just doesn't make any sense. Okay. We're talking about Peter Turnquest, and I'm trying to give him some time because yesterday I explicitly explained that the FNM isn't putting forward a public face as a party that understands that it just had a very devastating loss and that the same posture that they had in governance and in opposition before isn't going to go over well. All right? They need a catharsis in the FNM, a cleansing of leadership to put forward to the public that, okay, we understand that certain things we didn't do properly. You didn't like X, Y, Z about what was going on, and we're going to try to change. As far as a postmortem, it looks like Peter Turnquest is actually being contemplative of what went down. Now, here's what I think is going to happen. I think someone's going to nominate Minnis again at convention. Because you only need someone to nominate you. I think someone's going to nominate him again at convention, and he'll be in contention, right? Word on the street is, it's just word on the street in the FNM, right, is that Michael Pintard is talking to Dwayne Sands about teaming up on a leadership ticket, and they're trying to gin up enough support for Pintard to take over, all right? Now, Dwayne Sands has leadership aspirations as well. He's made no secret about that. But the smart money is, Pintard's already in the House. If you got Dwayne as your backup, we can try to get Dwayne in the House next lap, or we'll put Dwayne in the Senate, and he'll be a voice there as well. All right? So that's what looks like is shaping up. Turnquest says they need an more inclusive leader, someone who's going to embrace all the various segments of the party. All right? So the Minnis acolytes in the FNM were pretty much trying to sniff out who was still loyal to Ingram, because you know they had a big falling out with Ingram, which I don't really get that. You know, I wouldn't have taken that approach at all to say we're going to try to diminish Ingram's influence in the party. What you do is you work with Ingram. Take his advice. Someone's saying they don't think there's going to be a deputy leader race next month, just a leadership race. That could be true. That could be true. However, I thought all positions became open at convention. I wasn't aware you could have a convention and only open the leadership race. It was my understanding that every position opens up at convention. That's what's happened at all the other conventions. But maybe they could just have a convention for leadership, I guess. All right. Turnquest is saying that they want someone who's... Oh, okay, someone's saying they're doing the February convention. They're doing February, all right? So this one's leadership. February is for deputy. All right. That's still the word on the street that Pintard's talking to Dwayne Sands. Turnquest says they want someone who's willing to be open to consultation and advice from others, who will be confident in who they are and be able to express themselves with confidence and display the kind of vision and strength that's necessary to lead a party like the Free National Movement going forward, all right? He's looking for qualities, and he's speaking for the party, that are seen as weaknesses in Minnis. And this makes sense. And I give him credit for coming forward and speaking publicly to it. And it gives you the distinct impression that the Free National Movement is ready to move on from the leadership of Dr. Minnis. We got a phone call? That's fine. Good afternoon. Nope, you're gone. All right, nice thought. This says... The It says, Juan, good day. You stated Levin and Nahaja are not journalists. Are you then suggesting that the senior editor of Nassau Guardian, they should not interview politicians because they do not have the ability to ask tough questions? No, that's what you're picking up from it. That's not what I said at all. I said they don't understand how news coverage works. That's the only reason I said they're not journalists. They can interview whoever they want. They're, in fact, Nahaja has had quite a number of very good interviews with senior politicians, as is Levin, even though he doesn't interview politicians that much. We got a phone call. Let's go to a phone call. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Juan. How are you today?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks. I think ministers need to have a come-to-Jesus moment now in politics. I think, personally, that the minister era in politics is definitely over because he had a chance as the prime minister and he didn't perform. Now, I didn't say he didn't do anything at all, but he didn't perform up to the standard that the vehement people look forward to. But I think Peter Tankwist is on the right track with what he's saying at this time. Thank you.
All right. Appreciate it. So what Turnquest wants is to essentially reshape the image and branding of the Free National Movement. So a lot of people last term, they didn't like Minister's approach to a lot of things. Not the minister didn't have his fans, right? Tens of thousands of people still voted for him, yes? But a lot of people were turned off by certain things. And how you speak publicly is one of those things. And so when he says he wants someone who speaks with confidence, he wants someone who doesn't seem as if they're flustered when asked a question, even if it's a silly question. Someone who doesn't feel as if they're being combative when they're speaking to people and answering questions, all right? Someone who has a pleasant posture, right? Like, Minnis's resting face was often a kind of mishmash of a scowl and a look of distaste for having to talk to you. You know all the memes from the press conferences with like the varying Minnis looks. There's a reason for that, right? You don't see many memes of him being angry, right? Like with Chris, with like Ingram, you wouldn't see many memes of him being angry. With Christie, you wouldn't see many memes or photos of him being angry, except when he flashed the bird, right? But with Minnis, he just looked unpleasant a lot of the time, and you want someone who looks like they want to be there. And there would be this, and so many of FNM supporters got it so wrong, right? Because their response to people's critique of Minnis was always like, well, what y'all want? And if you were reading the room, you'd understand that we don't want that. We don't want to be spoken to like that. We don't want to be dictated to like that. We don't want someone who seems unpleasant and seems annoyed in the job. And this was the criticism of so many FNFs. Oh, y'all, Minnis tired of y'all. Minnis tired of y'all, for real? But if you tired, then what's, you know? So the general thought process that the people should amend their behavior because the prime minister doesn't like how they're responding to him is always a losing proposition. Because the people are unlikely to change. What is more likely to change is going to be the prime minister. All right, we got to take a break. We'll be right back.
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
You're listening to the Guardian News Network. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Here's the news at 1 o'clock. It is Friday, October 15th, 2021. Thank you so much for tuning in. The Ministry of Health and Wellness confirming an additional 14 COVID deaths between October 2nd and October 8th. The victims range in age from 26 to 91. 8 of those victims, men, 6 women, 9 of them from New Providence, 2 from Long Island, 2 from Inago, and 1 from Grand Bahama. The latest deaths bring the confirmed toll in the Bahamas to 622. An additional 123 people have also been confirmed to have died with COVID, but not because of it. Additionally, there are now 63 deaths under investigation. The Bahamas confirmed 64 new COVID cases yesterday, 47 the day before. Up to Thursday, 127 cases were hospitalized. The Office of the Prime Minister says it doesn't intend to re-engage scores of retired civil servants, but it defends the return to a prior established policy of paying pension and salary to those returning workers as an effort in equality. In a statement, the Office of the Prime Minister clarifying that so far only 2 former senior public officials have been re-engaged by the Davis administration and will receive their salary and pension to which they are legally due. It's a policy, the OPM says, has been enforced by successive previous governments, including the Minnis administration. The only difference, the statement claims, is the previous government, with characteristic favoritism and complete indifference to ordinary Bahamians, applied that policy just to the favored few, canceling it for all other workers. The Davis administration, we're told, believes that all re-engaged public officers should instead be treated fairly and equally. So all re-engaged public officers will again receive their pension. But the Prime Minister's office says such officers will be re-engaged infrequently, selectively on merit, with focus on filling assessed skills gaps. Prime Minister Philip Davis pledging his administration's commitment to the reconstruction of Abaco. He revealed his government is reviewing a proposal for 150 homes on the storm-ravaged island and accused the former administration of neglecting Abaco and making a bad situation worse. Jasmine Brown reports.
The Prime Minister gave an assessment of the situation in Abaco as he gave the keynote address at Abaco Business Outlook on Thursday morning.
Abaco wants change, big change, transformative change, and my government is committed to delivering it.
He insists that now that his administration is in office, it will be a government of action, as he revealed they are currently reviewing a housing building proposal to build 150 homes.
My government is already hard at work. In a speech from the throne last week, my government promised that in collaboration with the private sector and non-governmental agencies and organizations, we will implement immediate relief measures for Abaco, Grand Bahama, and we are a government which has already demonstrated its intention to keep our promises.
The Prime Minister added that he wanted to say more but could not until more was revealed about the country's financial state of affairs.
After only 4 weeks in office, I'm sure you will understand that I'm limiting my remarks for the time being to broad strokes. There's still much for us to uncover about the public finances. But even in this climate, and even with the challenges we currently face, there's much about which to be optimistic.
In opposition, the PLP was highly critical of how the Minnis administration handled the aftermath of Hurricane Dorian. The party slammed the Minnis-led government over the spending of hurricane relief funds, Dorian deaths, and the number of missing, as well as the lack of rebuilding of private and public buildings on Grand Bahama and Abaco. Davis says the fact of the matter is over the last 25 months, there has been little progress on Abaco and even Grand Bahama since monster storm Dorian slammed into those islands and caused widespread devastation.
The neglect of Abaco and Grand Bahama during the past 2 years makes the situation even worse. People cannot live without access to clean, potable water. Homes and businesses cannot survive and thrive without a reliable supply of electricity. Bureaucracy must not overwhelm people's needs to be able to build and buy homes. Safety and security measures are still ineffective.
Reporting for Guardian News Network, I'm Jasmine Brown.
The Bahamian embassy in Haiti has reopened. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs says its diplomatic staff returned to Haiti Sunday and have now resumed normal operations. That embassy temporarily closed following the assassination of Haiti's president back in July. A ban on travel between Haiti and the Bahamas has been in place since February. The Davis administration continues its review of that policy. That is the news at 1 o'clock. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Thank you for tuning in. Stay tuned for updates on the hour. And have a great afternoon.
Girl, Junior just showed me Bulla Boy in his phone.
What you mean? He take picture of that good for nothing boy?
Shh, you don't want Bulla hair. You say that. You know she always say that's my good child.
So what he doing in Junior phone?
Oh, he there because the police looking for him. He on that wanted list.
Wanted persons in your phone now?
Yes, child. And when police want find anybody quick, after something happened, they can send picture direct to your phone. Go to Google Play or App Store and search for Crack Crime Bahamas, then pick install and it will go straight to your phone.
There is also a section on missing persons?
Yes, girl. Everybody needs to get this app so police can tell us right away when these people go missing. Just like an alert system.
Yes, it has numbers for Crime Stoppers Bahamas so you can call and nobody knows you. Call directly to Miami and give the information without giving your name or anything about you. I tried it the other day and when I hear Junior and his boys talking about where they hide those guns, I walk quick around the corner and call that number.
Call 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
Always on the go? Missed the show? You can now listen to Guardian Radio talk shows anytime, anywhere on Spotify and YouTube by searching Guardian Radio 96.9 FM or by entering the name of your favorite show. You can also listen by logging on to guardiantalkradio.com and clicking on the podcast tab. Guardian Radio, continuing to provide you with fresh news and smart talk anywhere, anytime, all day.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day. We'll be right back.
Okay. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. We were having an open show today. We talked about several things. I guess we'll continue to talk about things after we speak with the Bahamas Alliance for the Blind and Visually Impaired. Joining me in studio, I have Desmond Brown, who's the first vice president of the organization, and I have Roberta Johnson, who is the recently elected president of the Bahamas Alliance for the Blind and Visually Impaired. And you're here today because International World Sight Day is celebrated in October, the second Thursday in October each year, and White Cane Day is celebrated on October 15th. Give me, which is right, correct. And so today is White Cane Day. All right. Now tell us how some of these things start, and tell us what the Bahamas Alliance for the Blind and Visually Impaired about the work that you do.
Okay. So in 1990, we realized that there was no organization here that speak on behalf of the blind and visually impaired. So we got together then, and we started what was known as the steering committee, which mushroomed into what we called then the fellowship. But in 1997, we realized, hey, let's formalize this, and we formed the Bahamas Alliance for the Blind and Visually Impaired. Mm-hmm. And the mission of the organization is to actively promote effective measures for the preservation of sight, for the education and training, rehabilitation, employment, and the well-being of all persons who are blind and visually impaired. So our work covers those areas, blindness prevention, although we are not medical, but we encourage that. We try to work as much as possible with medical personnel to do screening, with education and training. We do some of that, but we encourage education and training to all areas of society, employment, and housing, and all the works, the different things that persons enjoy in society. We work towards allowing blind persons to achieve as much as possible.
Okay, so let's go through a couple of things first. Mm-hmm. And again, please excuse my ignorance. What is the difference between blind and visually impaired?
Okay. A person, you want to go?
I will go ahead.
Okay, a person who is blind, like myself, have no workable vision, right. Okay? Mm-hmm. I may be, some person may be able to glimpse a little light or something like that, but no workable vision, useful vision. But a person who is visually impaired,
like myself,
they have some level of vision,
right,
anywhere below 20/20, which is the perfect vision. So, so visually impaired persons are those who are not totally blind but have
some
different level of sight.
Okay. Right.
Okay. So, Ms. Johnson,
yes.
Mr. Brown is wearing dark glasses.
Right.
You're wearing regular glasses, so
right.
You're visually impaired.
I'm visually impaired. I wear the glasses to take away the clouds, to help with assisting with my clarity, but it doesn't give me definition to read or. Like, I can see your face, but I can't describe you if I have to again.
Oh, I see. Okay,
right.
Interesting. So, were you both born blind and visually impaired, or did it develop?
Well, I became visually impaired in 2016, sitting at my desk one day. You know, I just realized I saw a lot of photos all the time and didn't know that those dots meant something. And I kept on saying, okay, I'll go to the doctor. And they got bigger and bigger and bigger. And I didn't realize that I was losing my sight. Mm. And by the time I had gotten to the doctor, I had already lost full sight in my right eye and have minimum vision in my left eye.
Wow.
Yes.
And is that something that's repairable, or
no,
is it just a condition you have to, it's a chronic condition?
It's a chronic condition. Once your retinal has detached, if you can catch it within a period of time, but once that time has passed, there's nothing you can do. And I've ran away and gotten many opinions, but there's nothing that could be done.
At this time?
At this time.
Okay.
50-50.
50-50.
Right, and I rather stick with, you know...
With what's going on now.
Exactly.
Right, yeah. So I asked that because if you were blind your entire life, Mr. Brown, or...
No, as a matter of fact, I had sight problem from, I know myself, from age of 3, I was told that I something hit me in one eye, and I had pretty good sight up to the age of 15. However, I was having problems in school because I could not see the chalkboard. Mm. So I went to the school for the blind, and by now some of you might realize that I'm from Jamaica originally. So I went to the school for the blind in Jamaica. There, I lost my sight totally, which was a very good thing for me because I was at the place where I could have received all the training, my education and everything. So from the age of 15, I am totally blind.
Okay. All right. Well, so I got to ask the obvious, besides from learning how to deal with the condition, because you were an adult when you were became very visually impaired.
Right.
But beside from learning how to live life with your conditions, how has it been, particularly with the pandemic? I've wondered that very much.
It's been difficult.
Yeah.
It's been very difficult with the pandemic, especially the cost for transportation for blind people just to go and do anything, visually impaired, disabled persons on a whole. Mm-hmm. It's been very difficult to be able to get things at leisure that you could have got. Like one time ago, you could have I could have walked or went to the food store, jumped in the bus or something like that. A lot of things has changed, and for persons like ourselves, transportation and getting around is very expensive and costly, and things are not easily at hand.
And you also we have to remember we are social. Humans are social beings, okay?
Right.
It affects everybody, but for us who are blind and visually, it depends upon touch.
Right.
I have to touch everything. Okay, if I am depending on a sighted guide, I have to hold on to that person.
Right. And everybody's
so it's
distancing.
Very difficult, and the social distancing make it very,
very, very difficult.
Very difficult.
Well, yes.
How many people would you say are in your organization, or if you could maybe estimate in the Bahamas, would be blind or visually impaired to the point that they would, you know, need someone to assist them with?
You know, this in the organization, we have going up to 70 person, and it's growing. However,
and adults.
The population of blind persons in the Bahamas, we really don't know.
Yeah.
Okay? Because the last census didn't do a really good job of even how many persons with disability here.
Really?
But we know by international standard, they say by any international standard, maybe about 1% of your population is blind, or up to 3% may have sight problem. Mm. So it tells me that a whole lot of people are walking around with sight problem, and some don't even know it.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. So you talked about blindness prevention. What does that entail?
Blindness prevention is really understanding that your eyes is yours to take care of. And also for our loved ones, like especially our children. And even though some type of blindness cannot be avoided, but the research is showing that up to 80% of blindness could have been avoided.
Yes.
If we just do the right thing. If
regular
we just
screening.
Do the screening, attend our doctors, wear protective gears while we're using dangerous food, for example.
Yes.
Every day we see people cutting their lawn, using, what they call it, weed walker on the lawnmower.
Yes.
How many times you see someone have their eyes protected?
Yeah, good point.
And it can something can easily fly up in your eyes and that's it.
Yes.
Motor vehicle accident, all kinds of stuff. So we can do a lot of things to protect our eyes, but we don't take care of our eyes the way we should. And when we lose it many times, we're not going to get it back.
Never.
Mm, wow, that's incredible. So you guys have a fundraiser coming up. Tell me about that.
Well, so we have to put off our fundraiser because of all the restriction and stuff like that. Okay, so we push it back. Hopefully before the year out, we'll get some leeway to to go get into that. However, we appeal to the general public that if you have some, if you want to donate to the organization, right, you can do so. And we can do so to our Facebook page. And
direct deposit to our bank account.
Our bank account to Scotiabank, right, on Bay Street. And whatever you can do to help the organization, for us to help our members to achieve our goals, because the organization is doing a lot of stuff. We do training in Braille and computer and smartphones and stuff like that. And we need help to transport members to and from events and all kinds of things.
And one of our biggest problem is we no longer have a home. You know, we as adults, as they lose their sight, we help them to try to rehabilitate, to get back to manage in their home properly, mm-hmm, and to be able to use the smartphones as a regular person, because there are apps you can use and softwares for the computers. But because we no longer have a home to do that, it's become very difficult for us to help to rehabilitate our new members.
What happened to the home?
So what happened to the home? What happened? We were renting a building from the Salvation Army, and right, they do some restructuring where they required the space that we were using.
I see.
And right, so therefore, it's nothing malicious. Okay,
right,
we understand
right,
that it's their building; they need it. So, but we are really appealing to the general public, right, even to the government,
right,
that if there is a vacant building that no one is using, we can use it and we can help blind and visually impaired person receive some of the training that is necessary to move on.
Yeah. Oh, I see. What kind of assistance do you get from the government now?
Well, the organization receive a small annual grant from the government. We're not going to say how much it is, but it's small. Okay, right, we are truly grateful for it. You know,
yes,
but it's small. Mm-hmm. Also, we work with government agency as much as possible,
right,
to achieve some of the goals that we want to achieve. But we need more help.
Yes, mm-hmm, definitely.
Definitely we need more help.
Someone is asking me if there are any blind athletes.
Any blind?
In the Bahamas, athletes. I don't know why they're asking that, but that's why they're asking.
We have, I personally
don't know, but we know there are
what they call Special Olympics.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right here in the Bahamas. I don't know that there are any blind person there. However, we have blind and visually impaired people who are very active, riding the bike and all those type of things in a protective way.
I just saw the other day on Facebook, there is a blind association that plays softball. I think it's softball or cricket. I came across it. So there is some form of athleticism. But to what extent, I don't know. But there is one in the Bahamas. I came across it just the other day on Facebook.
No, interesting.
And I was in touch with the West Indies Blind Cricket Association, who is very much interested in set up shop, helping us here to set up our blind team in the Bahamas, which we are working on. So blind and visually impaired persons are involved in a whole lot of things. The only thing that we just need to get the opportunity to get where we should be.
I gotcha.
And we're not really begging. We are not begging. We are just asking.
Yeah, asking for help.
Right.
Asking for help and asking for us to be allowed to live the life that we want to live. Because we are equal to everyone else as human beings.
Absolutely. Okay, so if they want to know more about the Bahamas Alliance for the Blind and Visually Impaired, you said you're on Facebook. What's the name of the Facebook page?
Bob V. Bahamas, or the Bahamas Alliance for the Blind and Visually Impaired. Same thing as Instagram. And our telephone number is 8080-BOB-V or 802-2284.
Okay.
Or you can email us at bobvbabvi.101@gmail.com. Okay, you can also reach us. But before we go, I just want to make one appeal. We talk about training. You see, I have my smartphone using, but there are a whole lot of blind persons out there who don't have a smartphone.
Right.
You know, I asked about that one time, and someone told me there's an app, and I saw when you came in, your smartphone.
Right, there are a whole lot of apps.
We're now trying to start a phone drive. So if you are in the possession of a used phone that you may not have. You know, or people are always updating. Sometimes they get new phones and they put them in a drawer. Mm-hmm. So if you are in the possession of a phone and you would like to donate to our organizations for one of our members to be to have a phone, you can drop it off to Social Services Disabilities Affairs Division. And you can ask for Ms. Hannah McPhee between the hours of 9 to 1 p.m. Monday through Friday. And she's our secretary for the organization, as well as she's the receptionist at Disability Affairs.
Okay.
And she will receive those phones, and they will definitely be dispersed to members who are in need, because we have many members who cannot afford the phones. You know, there are phones that you can always have a phone, but not all phones support the apps that blind use.
Exactly.
Right.
Do you have a GoFundMe page?
We are in the process of creating that.
Okay.
Yes, we are.
And that's an easy way for people to get to you.
Yes.
As well. Someone's asking me if people who are colorblind are considered visually impaired?
Yes. In some form, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. You have a visual problem.
Yes,
because you can't differentiate colors. Then,
right.
You know, I know people, I heard of situation where people walking and walk straight through glass.
Yeah, that really happened to me before at National Insurance, actually.
You can't differentiate.
I couldn't tell.
Right,
you know?
There was glass there.
Ooh. Right.
Oh, that's frightening.
Yeah, it was.
Okay, this person says, Juan, I almost lost my eyesight in 2018 to closed angle glaucoma.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I had intense eye pain and went to the doctor after a few weeks. It was terrifying. I had to have emergency surgery and then a number of surgeries afterward in Florida.
Right.
Fortunately, I had insurance.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'd started practicing moving around the house with my eyes closed because I really thought it would end in blindness. It's now corrected, but I now suffer from regular glaucoma.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And I'm on eye drops until I drop.
Right.
Please check your eyes regularly and don't put it off when you have eye
drops.
Most definitely. And like I said earlier, sometimes, and I think this happened a lot to people, you sit down at the computer and you see these little dots.
Mm-hmm.
And you take them for granted.
Right.
And it started with one dot with me, you know, and it just started multiplying. And then I saw them start to form into shapes. But I was like, okay, I could always go to the doctor.
Right.
You know, I could always get a checkup. But by the time, especially if you're going through the system, by the time as you get to the person that you need to see, because there's so many steps you have to go to get to the specialist, I had already lost my sight waiting to get to that specialist.
Right.
So don't take anything for granted. Anything for granted when it comes to your eyes.
Right.
Just a speck, even if your eyes strain, if you have headaches at night, anything.
Yeah, I checked I'm not significantly visually impaired in any way, but I wear glasses now.
Right.
Because my wife would see me like holding my phone like right up to my face.
Right.
to read and all this stuff like that.
Right.
And she'd be like, what's wrong? And I'd be like, the letters are fuzzy. I don't know. And I never wore glasses before.
Right.
And she said, why don't you go get it checked out? So I went and get it checked out. They prescribed me glasses. It feels much more comfortable now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
They check your eye pressure, et cetera.
Right, and that's important too. The pressure in your eye is very important.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Well, we encourage you to get your eyes checked out.
Definitely.
And take care of your eyes. And we hope that people will contribute to your cause.
Thank you.
It sounds like a home for the blind is an exigent need. And so we're hoping that somebody out there hears this and can accommodate. Mm-hmm. And they can find you on Facebook and Instagram.
Yes, they
can.
Definitely.
And we really need those used phones that you have in those drawers.
Mm-hmm.
Just drop them off to Disability Affairs at Terry Centerville. Social Services to Hannah McPhee between 9 and 1. There are a whole lot of blind persons out there who need to get
definitely
in, get in on the internet, get
just connected,
tune,
just to feel a part of. Because,
correct,
like I said, we have a lot of members who has lost their sight during adulthood. So at some point, they were connected to social media and all of that. And now they're feeling timid because they don't have one. They can't either afford the new phone so to get the apps or something like that. So what we're trying to do is bring everybody and connect them back together.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely. Well, best of luck and congratulations on another successful Blindness Awareness Month. It's the 13th White Cane Day.
Yeah,
yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Excellent.
Yes.
All right, good. Well, we wish you all the best, and we hope that you do get the support that you need.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very
absolutely
much.
It's a pleasure speaking with you.
Okay.
We're going to take a break, and we're going to come back on the other side, and we'll continue our discussions about other issues. Stay tuned.
Thank you so much.
Excellent.
Throughout our lifetime, we must all make decisions. No matter how we choose, the right one just needs to be made. Like having J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers as your insurance partner. We've been serving the Bahamas for over 100 years. Whether you need home, motor, marine, or commercial insurance, make the right decision. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com.
Wendy's, our food is made to make you crave. Crave our pretzel BLT burger or Chipotle crunch for only $5 each. Our Chipotle crunch chicken sandwich is covered in crispy jalapenos, Chipotle aioli, cheddar cheese sauce, and much more. Or bite into our pretzel BLT with fresh beef, cheddar cheese sauce, applewood smoked bacon, and smoky honey mustard sauce on a pretzel bun. Restrictions apply. Eat and earn reward members. Remember to scan or swipe to earn points. Wendy's, different inside and out.
October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Other than skin cancer, breast cancer is the most common cancer in women. Breast cancer is also the second leading cause of cancer death in women, after lung cancer. Can you help? Yes, you can. You can encourage women to take steps to help lower their risk of developing breast cancer and help find it early when it might be easier to treat. You can also help connect women facing breast cancer to patient programs and services they might need throughout their treatment. We encourage you to share these messages during Breast Cancer Awareness Month and throughout the year. 2021 has been a powerful reminder that we are all in this together, and our choices and actions have the power to protect the most vulnerable among us in a big way. By working together, we can inspire hope and become a force for good and help create greater awareness during Breast Cancer Awareness Month. To participate in our upcoming supplement, be sure to contact Guardian Media's advertising department today or your account executive.
Tips for keeping children healthy. Ensure that children are up to date with their vaccinations, including the flu vaccine. Make sure that your children practice preventative actions such as proper hand washing. Teach them to cover their nose and mouth with tissue or the inner elbow when coughing or sneezing. Encourage them to keep their hands away from their eyes, nose, and mouth. Explain that they should keep their distance from persons who are coughing and sneezing. Keep your children home when they are sick.
This message brought to you by Bahamas Ministry of Health in conjunction with Guardian Radio.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. We're not talking about anything very specific today. I am going to try to have this discussion about colonialism, race, inequity, colorism next week. But today we were talking about some journalism issues earlier, and then we were talking about what Peter Turnquist is saying the party is looking for, and they're definitely looking to move on from Dr. Minnis. This says, hi, I want Dr. Minnis to give me 5 million lines saying, I will not lock down, I'm sorry. Then I would consider an apology. It says, Juan, did you interview Raul Castro when you were in Cuba? No. Now, firstly, I don't speak Spanish, even though my name's Juan Carlos. And he was talking to some other people, but we were interviewing other people. I think the most notable person I've ever had the chance to, I guess you could call it interview, even though it was a pool interview, is Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton was very instrumental in helping the Bahamas receive AIDS medication, all right? He and Dr. Perry Gomez, the former Minister of Health, and he came down for his PEPFAR, some PEPFAR thing over here, kind of informally, and Wait, no, he was on vacation, I think they said. He was on vacation, and then he wanted to tour Victoria Gardens and look at the stuff that they had done with the AIDS in the Bahamas, you know? So, and in that instance, we only got a call from the U.S. Embassy, and they were like, hey, President Bill Clinton's going to be here. He wasn't president at the time. President Bill Clinton, but they still call him president, you know. President Bill Clinton is going to be at Victoria Gardens in about an hour, right? Because I remember it was a Sunday, okay? And you can come down. And it was supposed to be a photo op, but they told me it was Erica Wells was my boss. She said, just go down there anyway and see if he'll talk, right? And we went to Victoria Gardens, and Secret Service was all around. And then I believe it was Coralie Adderley came and brought him over to us. She referred to us as paparazzi. I'm not sure why. But, you know, he wasn't expected. It wasn't expected he was going to talk, but we started talking to him, you know. And so I buttered him up, asked him how the golfing was and all this. And he started talking about AIDS and all the work he was doing and everything. And we got a story out of it. But he talked to us. There wasn't any big formal process, right? So, and that's a U.S. president. And Secret Service was all over. It was kind of strange. The Secret Service people were wearing, like, floral shirts. Like, they were, I don't know why. Like, you can, we know you're Secret Service, dude. You're standing on point, like, scanning the area. We don't think you just came down to kick it with Bill Clinton, right? Anyway, that's says see if Bill Clinton will talk. That's like asking if your child wants chicken nuggets. I know he was happy to talk. He was there. They're talking. He's like, I've met like some celebrities before, you know, working at Atlantis, but Bill Clinton's like the most magnetic person I've ever met in my life. Right? Like he just exudes, it's coming off of him in waves, you know, just personality and charm. He's got a gift. All right. The Secret Service learned that when in the Bahamas do as Bahamians do. So they thought they were dressed like natives. Yeah. So that's, I know I didn't interview Raul Castro, but I did interview Bill Clinton. So I got that one under my belt. So I really did a couple heads of state. We got a phone call? Let's go to a phone call. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Juan McCartney.
Hey, man, how's it going?
This woman, Bill Clinton, is a Rhodes Scholar.
Bill Clinton? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes, so he's very smart.
Yeah.
When he left presidency, the U.S. was in a surplus. He had to, there's so much cash because he changed the tax codes. Now, let's get back to what at hand. During rally time, right, is slander off the market?
Slander?
Yeah, slander.
No, you could slander anyone at any time. It doesn't stop.
No, I believe ministry, bank, or chief to hurricane relief my money. And it's like,
He said in a roundabout way, right? And during the election campaign, we do carefully vet what we print. Right? Now, during the election campaign, however, you will give it a little more leeway in terms of just outlandish statements that they're making. So he's saying that the PLP, if you vote for Brave and the PLP, you can never see the hurricane donations.
Right? He used the word like race or squander. He said thief. They're like, wow. Now, suppose there ain't no money, there ain't no relief fund. Then it becomes modest.
Right, exactly. Right? Yeah, I mean,
because like I find believing that if there ain't no fund, you really slander my name. Because there ain't no fund, you're minister of finance. So why are you saying I got T for waste or some of the high grade money, knowing that there ain't none? But I got minister's graph, but throw anything on the wall, see if it stick. But Peter is right. Peter is so right that minister is so divisive to the FNM. Like he have the everything going on with him. Like, he create enemies upon enemies. Like, what? I don't know Helen Hunt, right? I think Helen Hunt is a smart woman. She talked to the press, and she really was talking to the press, and he really tore out the bitch with a lie, but he got to pick more people to go up on the Senate. And that was not true. And like Darwin Cass, Money Cam, Gomez, they are smart FNMs. And I surprised Papa let his people get massive without him. He ain't massive minutes back. But that's politics, I guess. Because he literally split up the FNM in different factions. And he, if you like you, he don't trust you. He put you on the back burner way down the road. Because he's insecure of Papa. I don't know, but everyone got to either do a radical mastectomy right now. It's painful, but another 4 years, they'll be right. Right?
All right.
It's a cancer.
Thanks, buddy. This says, British lawmaker from the governing party stabbed multiple times and died. He was meeting with constituents. Yes, I saw that, David. I think his name is MS. Sir David Amis. He was meeting some constituents at a church, and a man walked in and stabbed him. I'll say this, where you have, and it's being investigated by the counterterrorism, they believe it's a Muslim fellow, which is unfortunate. I was just listening to a story about a story about the increased tension between Saudi Arabia and Iran due to that they're warring with each other and they're fighting proxy wars because of the split in Islam between the Shia Muslims and the Sunni Muslims. The Sunni Muslims are vastly outnumber the Shia, but the Shia is being targeted by ISIL, etc. But anyway, I say that to say where these terrorist threats exist, you do have to be more alert about security for your elected officials, certainly. All right? It's unfortunate that you died. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, sir. And how are you today?
I'm great. How are you?
Fairly well, thank you, too. I'm very appreciative of the person who texted you about what happened in Essex.
Mm-hmm.
The gentleman who has a politics story since 1983, at the age of 69, was stabbed to death by a 25-year-old. They were talking. They don't know all the facts per se, but they're looking into it.
Yeah.
But there was a lot of condolences on social media. You know, well wishes. You know, people were grieving and in shock. And at the same time, there are persons who have no heart, so to speak, and they're actually celebrating and glorifying it. You know, so. It's just a warning and a saying that we ought to have a kindness of heart in the thing that we say on social media and on radio that can affect others, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
I also listened in the news and realized that as America opens up on the 8th of November, they will be accepting vaccines from other countries like Indian vaccine and also the vaccine from China. So that's some good news.
Absolutely. Thanks. Appreciate it. Says Juan, you sound like you know a lot about Islam. I know some. I had a very good friend in college, university, who was a Muslim. Tried to get me to become a Muslim, but that didn't happen. His father was from the Middle East. You would think, I'll tell you an interesting tidbit, since we're not really on any specific topic, right? That some things are surprising, right? So in the middle of Oklahoma, there's a significant number of Middle Eastern people, right? And you would think, well, how do they get there? Well, what happened is the University of Oklahoma, which I attended, has one of the best geology schools in the world. And so they're interested in... if you're interested in becoming a geoengineer, looking for oil, et cetera, minerals, you often would come there. And so we had people from all over, Pakistan, the UAE, right? Couple of Kuwait, right? And that's my friend's father. I believe is from Kuwait. I haven't talked to him in 20 years or 15 years, something like that. But yeah, I mean, you find out about Islam. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon.
Hey, how's it going?
Mr. McCartney, how you doing, sir?
I'm fine. How are you?
Yeah, I left my number a few weeks ago, and I was expecting a call, sir.
Is this Vincent Wallace?
No, sir.
No, this is somebody else. Okay, because I tried reaching Vincent Wallace.
No.
Leave your number for me again. I don't know if I have it.
Yeah, I left my number with your switchboard operator guy.
Okay.
I lived with him a few weeks ago, and I was expecting. I know it was the political season, and everybody's talking politics, but I got something juicy for you also.
Okay, great. So, yeah. Ali, get the number. Stay on the line. Okay. Get the number, yeah.
Thank you.
I'll reach out to you.
Thanks.
Vincent Wallace, I have the letter that you sent here for me, and we are going to put the word out for you. And you, too, are having trouble with your eyes. And we're going to address that early next week. All right? He says, I can see them now handing out the floral shirts before they got in the bulletproof cars and all the agents cussing and asking why they got to wear this island crap. Or if they were super professional, they might have been asking if there were any straw hats and a coconut with a straw to go along with the getup. Oh, Lord. Says, hey, Juan, can Minis take the other six MPs and make a new party different from the FNM? He's certainly free to do that, if they all agree to that. Says, hi, Mr. Clinton is also one of the persons responsible for the condition of Haiti. Yep, Bill Clinton Foundation, a lot of darkness went down in Haiti. Good afternoon, Juan and Bahamas. I've said repeatedly that Dr. Minis didn't need the big timers cash flow to win in 2017 because the people that mattered most were supportive of him. Big timers sensed that Dr. Minis was headed for victory. They came on board with him. Sadly, Dr. Minis forsook the masses, hence his massive defeat of the polls. I believe Dr. Minis is trying to prevent the political knockout, but I don't think he can avoid it. But repentance is still good for the soul, and it is available to us all. Yeah, certainly. This is one Minis is so petty and spiteful and insecure. The man who Papa made rich with the sand. Anyway, let me stop reading that. This is one, you remember during the election campaign, Davis said the police should investigate Adrian Gibson. He didn't make a complaint. Now the only way they can investigate if someone makes a complaint. So now Davis is PM. Why he still ain't make a complaint playing politics? Yeah, there's no complaint going on. With that, we got a break. Are we breaking here? Yep. Okay. We'll take a break, and we got a couple of calls. We'll deal with that on the other side.
And rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators, and the generator's back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them at 242-356-0249.
If you like Frito-Lay chips like Ruffles, Doritos, Cheeto Smart Food Popcorn, and Funyuns, you're going to love getting a chance to win great instant prizes. This Saturday, October 16th at Solomon's Yamacraw, join the Frito-Lay Island Wholesale Team between 12 and 3 this Saturday. Make a qualifying purchase of any Frito-Lay's chips or Smart Food Popcorn, and you get a chance to spin and win great instant prizes. And don't forget to put your contact info on your receipt and drop it in the promo box at Patience for a chance to win bicycles and hoverboards in the grand prize drawing November 27th. Frito-Lay chips distributed by Island Wholesale.
You have a new text message from Scotia.
Scotiabank is adding text messaging to its communication channels to keep customers updated in quicker and safer ways. As of November 4th, Scotiabank will be using text messaging to provide notifications on the minimum payment required for your credit card and due dates. Customers may continue to access their credit card statements on Scotia Online or through our mobile banking app.
Learn more by contacting customercare-bahamas at scotiabank.com or call 356-1697.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on 96.9 FM. Again, we weren't talking anything incredibly specific today. I'm going to get specific next week, though, so be prepared for that. Don't say I didn't warn you. It says, those people voted for the FNM, not for Minnis. It says, is there any point in having a defense force since they can't defend our borders, much less inanimate objects? Oh, boy. Their sole purpose is to protect politicians from us. Yeah, the Defense Force did get a black eye with that one. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, Juan.
How's it going?
How's it going, bro?
All is good.
It's Vincent Wallace. I listen to you every day, man.
Oh, okay. Thanks for calling.
I listen to you every day.
Yes.
But I didn't get your call, though.
No, I tried calling you, but I'm going to try. You probably got, maybe it was because of an unknown number. So I got my outgoing caller ID blocked, so I got to fix that. But I'm going to call you over the weekend, and we're going to see if we can talk about get you some help here. All right?
Okay. Appreciate it, man.
All right. Thanks a lot.
You know who this is? Let me remind you.
Mm-hmm.
Remember about a week or two ago, I called in and tell you, say, my girlfriend, tell me I love you, look like I love you more than I love her.
Okay. Yeah. I remember now.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, bro. But I listen to you every day, man.
Well, I appreciate it, man.
I row on your behalf and all.
Oh, good, man. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. They row for me. Oh, Lord. This says, Bill Clinton had to stop the Secret Service from shooting me and my coworkers for almost running over him with a golf cart. What? It was raining so hard that we could see him until the last second. We couldn't see him until the last second. He is as charming as Magic Johnson, Shaquille O'Neal, and William Shatner, whom I've all met. I've never met any of those. I saw a video of Shaq riding a bike around town. It says, Minnis is a megalomaniac who's more attracted to being living. He's an abject failure as a leader, and if the party keeps him, they deserve to implode and be left in the wilderness. My hope is that his parliamentary colleagues have a vote of no confidence as soon as possible and have him removed as leader of the opposition. He has to be rejected at every turn. It says, you said the lady brought Bill Clinton over. I bet Bill Clinton looked around, then asked her in his soft southern drawl, are those microphones I see over there? We were waiting. It says, why didn't you become a Muslim? Just asking. You believe in Christianity more? I met some who did. But why didn't you? I didn't feel as though that was right for me. And I remain a Christian to this day. But it's a very beautiful religion, right? Just not for me. All right, this says, when is the PLP government going to start the... I'd like to know that as well. Also, jobs of employment need to have everyone to be tested weekly, whether you're fully vaccinated or unvaccinated, because the science says that fully vaccinated persons can still contract and spread the COVID-19 virus. So why are fully vaccinated persons exempt from weekly testing when they can spread the virus to vaxxed and unvaxxed? I think you've sent this text before, and I agree with you. I'd like to know when they're going to start free testing. And I don't understand the distinction between being vaccinated, unvaccinated, and needing a test and not needing a test. This is, Juan, I'm an FNM, and we're ready to move on from Dr. Minnis. He has to realize that his era is over. TurnQuest is totally correct. The FNM needs to rebrand. All right. We got the phone call? Yeah? No? Okay. Yes? Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mark.
Hey, brother man, how's it going?
Yeah, second, yeah. You know, listen, firstly, right?
Mm-hmm.
I would like for the PM, I got offended. Tell him keep God out of politics, because we know politics is based on the Machiavellian ideas, which is subterfuge, whatever it takes to keep the power, right? They keep going out of it. And then there's another thing is, Stephen Arnold, as far as the science with the vaccinations, he seems to be infringing. You want to push people to the fringes of society for not being vaccinated, when the last text just explained the inefficacy of the vaccinations. So you're still having mutations. And so my individual rights, as long as don't intrude on the collective rights, then I should still have my rights. You don't, Stephen Arnold don't really understand philosophy, you know. That's law. You see, if I kill someone, that affects someone else. But me not taking a vaccine, it doesn't stop transmission. So he needs to go, look, I can get the information, I can send it to him, so he can read it for himself, man, all right?
Okay, cool. Yeah. All right, thank you. Stop, Stephen. Now, I hear the rationale that says if you're vaccinated, you're reportedly 10 times less likely to transmit, and that may be the concern, but you can still transmit, all right? It says, Juan, you have all kind of bromance going on. My husband is a dedicated listener, too. Shout out to O'Brien Knowles Jr. Shout out to O'Brien Knowles. All right, Jr. Good man. The mausoleum you went to school with, the Muslim you went to school with, live large like the ones I went to school with, live large like the off-white and white Haitians. They made me seem poor. Yeah, his father was an oil engineer who worked for one of the biggest oil companies in Oklahoma. He was set, right? So he did live large, very much so. Right? But he was dead. I had some friends who were Muslim, and they were off the chain. Like, they would drink. You're not supposed to drink in Islam. They would drink. They wouldn't eat pork. They would party, you know what I mean? The guy who I'm talking about, he was devout. He would ask me to come to the mosque with him. Says, when is the PLP going to start provide free testing? You just sent me that. Says, who moved the barrier from Munnings Drive? Good question. I'd like to know as well. All right, we're out of time. We didn't specific thing today, all right? And or anything with any great level of specificity, and that's okay. Sometimes that happens. Sometimes it's just good to talk and communicate. If the Lord tarries and keeps me, I'll be back on Monday, and we will talk about some more, well, depending on what happens over the weekend, we'll see. But I have some more specific focus things planned for next week. Again, and I think you'll find them interesting. All right? But you guys take care out there. Have a great day, Bahamas. Z Live off the record. Wish Varga Lang is up next. Enjoy your weekend.
It's gone.